Hey, Mimi, how have you been?
What's up, Issei? I feel so tired and low energy because quarantine, it really sucks, bro. But what about you?
Yeah, I feel that. I scroll through TikTok for distraction, but I can't even escape there anymore.
Your brother got the results.
He has it, doesn't he?
He has it. He tested positive for coronavirus.
COVID-19.
Coronavirus.
Coronavirus.
The coronavirus.
It's corona time.
Coronavirus.
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 That's so crazy. I hate TikTok for that. But I feel like coronavirus is affecting like every single aspect of our lives right now. Like for me, I'm super sad about not having my senior spring. It was supposed to be my last 3 months of high school to just chill and celebrate after a rough 4 years.
Yeah, my junior year has been really weird to adjust to. SATs have been canceled, and it makes me wonder if this hurts my chances of getting into the colleges I want.
Whoa, that's rough. Junior year is already so stressful as it is. And even for like other students too, the biggest way we're being impacted is through school closures. Everything from like SATs to graduations are just being canceled.
On this episode of the Radioactive Podcast, we're diving into how the coronavirus pandemic has disrupted education and how the virus has highlighted school funding inequities that have existed for decades. In this day and age, there's a lot of uncertainty for students. We wonder when school will start again, if we'll walk in our graduation, and what will happen to the rest of our education. We asked students in the Seattle area about their experiences, concerns, and questions during this pandemic.
As an extroverted person, it has made me anxious. Not having the ability to socialize or have physical interaction has caused me to feel alone and thus causing this anxiousness.
I fear that as students lose motivation, they won't want to learn as much, and then that will kind of inevitably change the entire learning experience overall. All juniors are in the same boat. None of us know what's going to happen in the future, and that none of us are really alone.
I especially felt very sad when, you know, I saw that email where they said that there won't be any graduations because of the pandemic, because it was almost as if my dream of, you know, being able to walk and get my diploma and, you know, my family gets to see me, you know, make this achievement is taken away from me.
You just heard from Washington State High School students, Michelle Rogers, Eden Voss, and Marianne Muhammad.
This is such a stressful time, and I feel for every student right now. But I can especially relate to Marianne, because I really want to walk across the stage and physically get my diploma. Like, really bad, bro. Like, I've been imagining that moment since, like, last spring.
And it's important to remember that this pandemic is affecting each student differently. Some students are able to continue online classes, but there are other students who can't because they don't have access to a computer or the internet, and it all ties back to school funding.
Yeah, that's exactly why when the pandemic hit in Washington State and the officials closed the schools for 2 weeks, they decided no district was allowed to offer remote learning. And the reason was equity. They knew some students wouldn't have access to the internet and or computers during those 2 weeks. And not every school and district has the funding to provide students with the materials they need to continue online learning. But then, Governor Jay Inslee closed schools for the rest of the year, and that's way too long to not offer any type of schooling for students. So now, state officials have decided to require all districts to offer some type of remote learning. But funding inequities are still preventing many students from having resources they need to continue their learning.
All of this had made things pretty unpredictable. State officials' indecisiveness has made students really anxious about the future of their education. And it's made school funding inequities even more obvious. So we talked to two students from the Seattle area about how all of this has affected them.
First, we talked to Paul Noon, who's a junior at Mercer Island High School, a public high school in a wealthy area where only about 3% of the students come from low-income households. And Paul says the switch to online classes hasn't been too bad for him. He still gets up at 8 in the morning to go to class, and he still sees his classmates pretty much every day.
Today, the classes weren't that long. It was a good day. You know, it's tiring being on Zoom calls and not seeing people's actual faces and hearing their actual voice, but it's just like a picture on a screen and a recording almost. It's just not as engaging.
I can totally relate to Paul. While I'm grateful I can continue my learning, I'm still really sad I can't see people in person, and it's really hard to stay focused sometimes.
But here's the thing. Not everyone has the privilege of having Zoom classes and a routine every day. Next, we hear from Kidis Tapde, who's a junior at Rainier Beach High School. Rainier Beach is a public school where roughly 72% of students come from low-income households. Remember, Paula's school only has 3%. Kadist hasn't been able to continue all her classes over Zoom.
My classes aren't really necessarily like classes, if that makes sense. Like assignments from our class, our classes are posted on Schoology and then we just complete it and submit it. But only for some of our classes, our teachers offering, you know, Zoom calls as a class or emotional support. But it's usually just as an option because obviously not everyone has internet or Wi-Fi access. It really just feels weird and difficult because like there's no longer really any structure in a lot of our lives, which, you know, school gave us for pretty much most of us our entire lives. And it's also just hard to be productive because it's difficult to like find quiet places to do schoolwork in. And there's just so many distractions as well with our phones and whatnot.
In fact, some of Kadist's friends call her for updates because they might not have their own Wi-Fi.
Well, I've had, you know, friends call me asking me for updates, and, you know, assignments, you know, asking me if I can run them through these assignments to the best of my ability so that they don't miss out on too much and can be prepared for college and, you know, high school graduation.
So, Mimi, let's actually talk about why Paul and Kadist's experiences are so different.
Well, remember, Issei, around 72% of the students at Rainier Beach come from low-income households. So there are probably a lot of students who need equipment from their schools to continue their learning online. While at Mercer Island, only about 3% of students come from low-income households, so the majority of the students probably don't need much equipment from school to continue their online learning. However, because of the ways that schools are funded, Mercer Island has enough money so that they could provide laptops and hotspots for the students in need if they needed to, while Rainier Beach does not.
But doesn't Rainier Beach have a way higher percentage of students of color than Mercer Island? I read recently that Rainier Beach is 97% students of color, predominantly Black, while Mercer Island High School is 70% white students. How does this play a factor in funding inequities?
Well, it's important to know that funding inequities contribute a whole lot to the achievement gap between Black and white students. Predominantly POC and Black schools, like Rainier Beach, that need extra funding and support aren't getting it, while predominantly white schools, like Mercer Island, are. And the students who need the most support aren't getting it because of these lack of resources. And so achievement gaps continue to exist.
Okay, that makes sense. I recognize that Mercer Island has the funding that they need to afford those resources. But where would Rainier Beach get that extra funding for materials like hotspots and laptops?
Okay, so the funding category is called MSOC, Materials, Supplies, and Operating Costs. And the money comes from the state. But that isn't always enough for a school or a district. So extra money for materials and technology can come from local funds, like local levies, and sometimes even PTSAs.
PTSA stands for Parent Teachers Student Association, right?
Yeah, they're parent fundraising groups for individual schools, and wealthier parents means more money for a school. And get this, Mercer Island was able to raise $64,000 from PTSA funding in 2018, while Rainier Beach raised zero. Rainier Beach's PTSA does work hard, but the school just doesn't have wealthy parents to donate to it like Mercer Island does. And for all schools, but especially for a school like Rainier Beach that can't rely on PTSA funds for extra support, money from tax levies is necessary.
And what exactly is a local levy?
So, local levies are like property taxes at the district level. Since Mercer Island has high property values, the Mercer Island School District is able to raise a lot of money through these levies. But Seattle has lower property values, so Seattle Public Schools doesn't bring in as much money through these levies. Seattle is also a much bigger district, so it would need a lot more to be able to distribute this money equitably. And all of this makes it so that if Mercer Island needed extra money for supplies for its students in need during this time, it would have it, while Rainier Beach wouldn't.
So I'm still stuck on the fact that Mercer Island was able to raise $64,000 from just PTA funding. But Rainier Beach didn't even raise a dime. Like, that is absurd to me.
No, it's actually so crazy. And these inequities aren't a new topic for Kadist. The student from Rainier Beach we heard from earlier, she and four other students founded an organization called Black and Brown Minds Matter to help raise awareness about school funding inequities and how they affect Rainier Beach along with other underfunded schools. And we had the chance to ask her about how this current pandemic is affecting her community.
when you look at the stats, you'll see how many students at Beach come from low income backgrounds, how many are homeless, how many don't have access to Wi-Fi, and see that Rainier Beach High School already lacks the adequate funding from the state and district to support students. And because of that, that will set us back even farther. And the achievement gap will really only widen, not even locally, but on a national and even global level.
We also asked her what the district could have done to better support their students.
Had they taken action from the get-go and created an action plan for students, teachers, and families for any potential possibilities, including online learning, a lot more could have been avoided, especially this tough transition that a lot of us are going through.
It's not like students didn't need this kind of technology last year. If students were provided with laptops and hotspots before this crisis, I feel like things would be a little different. But since they weren't, we asked Cadiz what she thinks the district can still do to best support all of its students.
Unless you are in the position of marginalized communities, no amount of reading, you know, books, no amount of doing research really is going to help you understand. And that's why, you know, the ones being oppressed, the ones who are the ones being vulnerable, they're the ones who should be at the forefront of, you know, the decision making. They're the ones who should have, you know, the say in the decisions that are ultimately going to affect us.
So Cadiz says that students should be heard and included in conversations when school officials make decisions. But she doesn't mean that the burden of reforming education should fall on our shoulders.
And I mean, like, as extraordinary as this is as well, we also have to understand that the youth are really under immense pressure as it is, you know, especially now. And it really shouldn't be us carrying the burden of creating solutions. You know, unfortunately, this is really just another example of the adultifying of Black and Brown children and making them, you know, by making them responsible for what should have been adult jobs, you know, from the get-go.
Well, the adultification of Black and Brown students, that's something that's really important to think about.
Exactly. Cadiz brought up a really important issue regarding systemic racism. Black and Brown students are already at a disadvantage because of how the education system is built. And then they are asked to take on even more responsibilities.
Yeah, and while it's important for the students to voice their needs, they shouldn't have to constantly fight to be heard. They shouldn't be responsible for solving a district's problems either. Districts need to put a lot more effort to listen, understand, and accommodate to different students' needs.
Right, we need a healthier relationship between students and district leaders. Students should advocate for what we need, and the district should figure out how to respond to those needs. Pandemic or no pandemic.
So we know the coronavirus is highlighting funding inequities, but the pandemic is also going to have long-term effects on the achievement gaps that already exist between students. To learn more, we talked to Julia Worth, who is the Director of Policy and Research at the League of Education Voters. Lately, her work has been helping students and families get access to the tools they need to ensure learning is still happening. And she talked to us about how there's a lot of work ahead even after schools reopen.
In the long term, we need to keep asking these questions, right, about what has the impact of this been on students of color? Did they have the same access to learning resources as white students in this time of crisis? And making sure that when schools reopen, we have the resources and the tools to support students and catch students up. Because there is certainly the potential for students to lose learning being out of school for this long.
So regardless if there's a crisis or not, school districts should provide accommodations and resources for their students to succeed. And this pandemic can be a good time to make change in our education system. Julia says right now is a great time to reach out to your elected officials, from state representatives to school board members.
Ultimately, they're the ones making the decisions about where money is going, which schools are getting what resources, and we need to make sure that they are hearing from students who are most impacted by these decisions, right? And who might not have access to the counselor or the nurse that they need in their school, or don't have access to the Wi-Fi hotspot through their PTA. So I would say those are kind of concrete things you can do even right now.
The most vulnerable students are going to lose learning as a result of this pandemic. So while districts are working to supply materials for students right now, it's also important for us, like Julia said, to reach out to elected officials on what changes need to be made when our schools reopen.
We all recognize that there's some pretty big disparities between schools that aren't funded equally. But now what? How easy is it to change how the educational system works? This has all made me realize that the issue was much more complex than I thought, and there isn't a simple solution.
Yeah, that is why it's so hard, because it's not just one or two things that need to be changed, it's the whole system. And I think that it's really important for everyone to start prioritizing advocating for funding equity, because if students everywhere came together and advocated for equity in education, we can make actual change. Because again, it shouldn't be only on the kids who are already at a disadvantage to be the only ones advocating for change. It should be on everyone. So this is the time to do our research, understand funding inequities, and talk to our elected officials.
These inequities in education have been around for a minute, but I think Julia's right. Now could be a time to make major changes. The system is broken. Maybe it takes a pandemic to actually do something about it. And that's a wrap on our episode. Thank you to everyone who we heard from today. Paul Noon, Kadiz Hapte, and Julia Worth. You can follow the Instagram account for Black and Brown Minds Matter at black.brown.minds.matter to keep up with what the organization is doing.
And you can visit the League of Education Voters website to learn more about education inequities and stay informed on education bills.
We would also like to thank all of our Vox Pops participants, Marianne Mohammed, Eden Voss, and Michelle Rogers.
And special thanks to our executive producer, Charlotte Engrav, our fabulous podcast mentor, Mary Heisey, and our amazing editor, Kelsey Kupferer.
If you want to hear more from us and our fellow Radioactivians, subscribe to our podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or find us at KUOW.
If you want more updates, follow us on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and TikTok with the handle Radioactive Youth Media.
Signing off, it's your girl, Issei Paulos.
And Mimi Zekaryas. Bye!
On April 6th, Governor Inslee announced that school buildings will be closed for the rest of the academic year.
All public and private K-12 schools in our state, they'll be stopped from providing traditional in-person instruction through the end of this school year in June.
In Mercer Island School District, classes resumed online for most students on April 13th. But for some, that won't be enough. Radioactive's Meghana Kakubal has more.
When the closure first began in early March, everyone faced uncertainty. For me, a Mercer Island High School senior, my concern was graduating on time. I wasn't worried about my learning, because I knew for me it would continue online. It isn't ideal, but it will work. Unfortunately, the same can't be said for all the students in my school. Christine Kenyon is a special education teacher there.
Students who might be placed in a classroom like mine might have multiple disabilities. Some might have genetic disorders. Some might have Down syndrome or autism. Some might be nonverbal learners. Fine motor and gross motor skills might be different than their peers.
Ms. Kenyon's students have very different needs and methods for learning than I do. Their typical day is not a strictly structured 7-period schedule with assignments and exams. I visited Ms. Kenyon's classroom earlier this spring, and students were working on life skills, like counting change and operating technology.
Hi.
Hi, William. How are you?
What's your name?
I'm Sarah.
You're Sarah?
Yeah.
They also work on these skills outside of the classroom.
So we get to ride the bus and go to McDonald's and have social time and practice how to be in the community. So interacting with cashiers, using our money, all the things that are expected in the community. And then our 5th period class goes to the grocery store, so they get to practice their shopping skills.
The school closure forced these activities to stop.
I actually had some tears that morning because I knew that it would be the last time I would be seeing my students for a while, and I didn't know what it looked like past that point, and that made me feel really, really sad. And I felt sad for them because I knew how much they loved coming to school, and I felt like we were suffering a considerable loss.
In the initial weeks after the closure, Mercer Island School District administrators asked teachers to focus on social and emotional connections with their students. My general education English teacher and I had several email exchanges. For Ms. Kenyon, that meant creating 9 individualized learning plans to support her students and families at home. But moving forward, Ms. Kenyon wonders how she can be an effective teacher for her students with individualized needs.
Each kid will be different. I've got some kids who are eager to learn and have some parents or caregivers who are ready for the challenge. And I have some kids whose families are not going to be okay with that.
During his April 6th press conference, Governor Jay Inslee briefly acknowledged the issue.
We know closing schools also presents challenges in the need for equity in education. Students with disabilities and other vulnerable students, we know this is a challenging time for their learning. So we are addressing this by allowing limited school activity for those students in school buildings that really follow social distancing guidelines.
How and when exactly this will happen are still big questions. Ms. Kenyon remains hopeful. In any case, there's no good way to replace trips to the grocery store and face-to-face interactions common in the classroom. Ms. Kenyon says this inadequacy cannot be ignored.
It's a civil rights issue, and it is important for all children in the United States to be given a free and appropriate public education. And I know how hard people with disabilities have had to work to gain recognition in the workforce, recognition in schools, safety, being able to even get into buildings. And once they've received that protection, there is no way we should be taking that back at this time just because of a pandemic. I don't care. It's really important for the public to keep that in mind and to be generous at heart.
In the meantime, Ms. Kenyon's going to support her students as best as she can virtually. For Radioactive, this is Meghana Kakubal.